of a God who always causes us to triumph. He is not caught off guard by any of our life situations. Everything, the hardship, the trial, the storm, is not happening to us. It's happening for us. For we know that all things work together for the good of those who love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. So don't give up. We don't have to worry. Our God is intentional. Let's go.
Thank you. Good morning, church. Praise the Lord. God is good all the time. All the time, God is good. I welcome all of you in the name of the Lord. And I'm so glad that you are with us this morning. This morning, we will have new worship experience. We will join this online worship through the GNJ-UMC conference worship resources. So we will join the hymnals from other pastors and other musicians in Greater New Jersey churches, members, and sermon from other pastor, and prayer, and it'll be a wonderful and blessed experience for us. So while we prepare our heart for our worship this morning, I want to begin with another big news for our church first. We have been working through the reopening committee and the church council members. And on last Tuesday, we have decided to reopen our church on July 19th, the third Sunday of July. I know there are still, this virus is going around us, even though these data and statistics shows us the number has been dramatically decreased, but there is still, I know, concern out there. So we're going to communicate all of you through the detailed instructions. But by trusting God with precautions and working together to make this safe worship environment, we will resume our in-person meeting. I hope this is a good news for all of us. But I'm going to get back to you through the time of announcement. So, prepare our hearts and mind, and we're going to join our service this morning.
Hello, and welcome to this time of worship together. We're so glad you've chosen to worship with us today. My name is Emily Wilton, and I serve as the Breakthrough Coordinator for the United Methodists of Greater New Jersey. Our worship service today is themed around moving the mountains in our lives. Please join me in the call to worship. We are surrounded by a cloud of witnesses, those who have shown us what it takes to be people of faith, those who have loved, healed, and spoken out towards injustices in places we couldn't. God, give us courage. Inspire us to follow in their footsteps, taking on the mountains in our way.
Hey.
Please join me in a word of prayer. God of us all, you have remained faithful to generation after generation. In every time and season, you have changed hearts and minds so that your way could reign. Help us when we get weak and discouraged to still live as your children in the world. Continue to open us up to encounter your presence around us, seeing the world with eyes and hearts like yours. Move us, O God. Amen.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won, for you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands, great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence, you never failed me yet. I know the night won't last, your word will come to heart will sing your praise again. But Jesus, you're still enough. Keep me within your love. My heart will sing your praise again. Your promise still stands, great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands, this is my confidence, you never fail. Your promise still stands, great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. Still in your hands, this is my confidence, you've never failed me yet. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness.
Our scripture reading today is Hebrews 12, verses 1 and 2. Listen now for a word from the Lord. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith, let us strip off every weight that slows us down, especially the sin that so easily trips us up, and let us run with endurance the race God has set before us. We do this by keeping our eyes on Jesus, the champion who initiates and perfects our faith. Because of the joy awaiting him, he endured the cross, disregarding its shame. Now he is seated in the place of honor beside God's throne. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Please pray with me. Come, Holy Spirit, open our minds to see the power of Scripture to offer new perspectives. Enlighten our hearts that we might see Christ in all whom we meet. In the name of the one holy and living mountain-moving God, to whom we give all glory. Amen. I have a motto that I live by. How hard can it be? I put that motto in effect a few years ago when I planned and executed my very first garden in the backyard of the parsonage in Connecticut. I planted tomatoes, mustard greens, cucumbers, and green bell peppers. Like many first-time gardeners, I did not exactly know what I was doing. And I figured that if I put the seeds in the dirt and watered them when it did not rain, fruits and vegetables would magically appear after several weeks of care. Much to my surprise, gardening takes a whole lot more effort than planting seeds and unraveling the water hose every once in a while. I found that the tomatoes required a stake to keep them from falling over after they reached a certain height. That I should prune the plants and pull weeds from the garden bed. And that cucumbers need something to lean on in order to grow. But the most important thing that I learned was how difficult gardening can be. Gardening requires a great deal of work. My first year, I harvested a decent amount of cherry tomatoes, enough for a few salads. 3 heads of mustard greens that were too pungent to eat, 2 cucumbers, but not one mature bell pepper. Not one. I never figured out exactly what was needed to help them grow. I made sure they had the proper sunlight. I watered them. I staked them when they appeared too heavy to stand on their own. I added fertilizer. I did everything that my Google search suggested to successfully grow bell peppers, and yet none grew to maturity. Needless to say, I was disappointed. I was disappointed because I expected my labor to bear fruit. I expected my hard work to pay off. I expected my diligent care to lead to a bumper crop of food to eat. Many of us are well versed in the anguish of disappointed expectations. We have all, at some point or another, loved someone who did not love us back. We have poured our hearts into providing our children with everything that they need to grow and flourish, only to find that things somehow still manage to go awry. We have worked tirelessly in the church on an event, only to find out that no matter how much of our hearts, no matter how much of our time, no matter how much of our passions and gifts we gave, no matter how many of our prayers we prayed, and no matter how much of our money we poured into our much beloved ministry, it was not enough. We have all experienced at least one occasion where we have done everything right, only to have our efforts return little or bitter fruit. This morning, we consider a portion of Paul's letter to the Hebrews, where just prior to our text, he writes of the ancient figures of the Bible, judges, kings, and prophets, who are hailed for their faith in the face of persecution, even to the point of flogging, imprisonment, stoning, and being sawn in half. The previous chapter reads like a who's who of the faith. Abel, Enoch, Noah, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Joseph, Moses, and Rahab are all cited for their faithfulness during turbulent times. Just as the church has persevered by faith through the persecution of the early church, institution of the universal church, inquisition of the Catholic church, reformation, and repeated reconstitutions, the church will persevere through this pandemic, so long as we are sure to put on our mountain-moving glasses. Like the great cloud of witnesses who modeled faith in the face of great persecution and saw beyond their present pain to the promise of perfection, when we put on our mountain-moving glasses, we are able to see not only with our physical eyes, but also with our spiritual eyes. Our mountain-moving glasses allow us to see and attest to the unseen works of the Spirit, for it is through our spiritual eyes that we are able to see in Jesus God's redemptive work that is ongoing even to today. We are able to see beyond our present condition and trust that the one who came in the flesh to dwell with us, guide us, and love us is still at work for us, with us, and through us. Our mountain-moving glasses should not be confused with rose-colored glasses that proclaim that everything is coming up roses, even in the midst of a death-filled pandemic. They are not glasses that call us to not see things as they are. No, we see the devastation to our social and economic lives. We witness the suffering of those who have lost loved ones, and we experience the pain of isolation. But our mountain-moving glasses allow us to see that what we are experiencing right now is not the end of the story. Paul tells us that even in the midst of adversity, even in the face of disappointment, and even when our efforts seem to go unappreciated, we are to endure until the end. He says in verse 2 that Jesus' perseverance in faith led to a cross on the mountain of Calvary, where death for one led to new life for all. Now that's good news for us, because it declares that when we persevere, we realize that the obstacles that seem like mountains may actually be opportunities. Opportunities to grow in faith, opportunities to grow in influence, and opportunity to grow in numbers. Right now, we face the mountain of coronavirus, the mountain of racism, the mountain of sexism, the mountains of poverty, greed, and hopelessness. Because our mountains are so great in size and enduring over time, we cannot afford to shrink back in fear. We must lean forward in faith and put on our mountain-moving glasses. in the garden of our world. We must keep planting love, keep planting peace, keep planting hope, and keep cultivating our faith gardens. Because though moving mountains isn't easy and tending our spiritual gardens may sometimes seem futile, because of our perseverance, those who are hungry for food are being fed through our food pantries and partnerships with local restaurants. Because of our perseverance, those who are disappointed and dejected are being supported and sustained through calls, letters, and our advocacy work. Because of our perseverance, those who are lost in a cycle of unbelief are being led into the marvelous light of our Savior through our online worship services and outreach. We are moving mountains, and because we have fixed our mountain moving eyes on Jesus, faith's pioneer and perfecter, we can see that though things may look bleak right now, we serve a God who has emboldened and empowered us to move mountains. A God who is the great gardener who never tires of pruning, watering, and caring for his creation. A God who has promised to toil with us and through us until we become the bumper crop that she envisioned at creation. Just as the church managed to survive and even thrive during the most trying of times, if we put on our mountain-moving glasses, we too will come out on the other side of this pandemic stronger, healthier, and better equipped to move the next mountain that comes our way. It's going to take hard work. It's going to take learning new ways of being and operating. It's going to take teamwork and cooperation. It's going to take perseverance. But if we do the work, if we learn the new lessons, if we work together, if we persevere, we can move this mountain and more. We can stay in love with God. We can stay in love with each other. And we can reach new people with Christ's love that is within us. We serve a mountain moving God, and we are mountain moving people. Let's go move some mountains. Amen.
Let us have time for offering. Let us pray together. From the abundant ways in which God has blessed our lives, let us share our tithes and offerings in joy and gratitude. Let them be used in ministries of peace and justice through the work of this church in your world. Amen. Let us pass the peace of Christ to each other. Peace be with you. Peace, everybody. What a great opportunity that we worship through all the members in Greater New Jersey Annual Conference. And what a wonderful singing and powerful sermon. And it's really a new experience. I really thank God for this opportunity. And I really thank you for you still joining with us this morning. So this is official now. Like I announced you in the beginning of our service this morning, our church, Hank Hessen United Methodist Church, will resume our in-person meeting in this sanctuary on July 19th, the third Sunday of July. But there are a few things we still need to remember. So, Hackensack UMC will continue to maintain online worship service even after we reopen our church. So, we don't know till when we're going to provide this online worship, but if once we open, we don't quite expect all of you to come back. But through the survey result shows us that once we reopen, one-third of our members responded that they will come back with precaution. So as long as sanitization and the cleaning and the preparation and protocol is set up, and if they think the environment is safe, they say they will come back. So this is the sign that we give to our community as well. We are open now. But I still advise you, strongly advise you, members in the vulnerable category of 65 and older, or those who live with persons who fit into that category, I encourage you to remain home and take advantage of online worship experience. And members and who have significant pre-existing condition should also be encouraged to remain at home. So many things will be different. So next Sunday and in the following Sunday, we're going to show you what will need to be changed and what you really need to expect once you come back. But first thing, you should be wearing your mask at all time throughout the worship. While you are staying here in this building, you must wear a mask. So be prepared to show up with face covering, clothing mask, or whatever the mask you have, it's okay. And the church have purchased some mask. So if you don't have one, please let us know. And second, everybody who will be coming into the sanctuary, they will be checked their temperature. So I know it's a very strange that you have to check your temperature to come into the sanctuary and to worship God. I know, but maybe we should be now get used to this new normal, but until everybody feels safe. So this is to create really safe environment for everybody. And there will be no touch based for everything. Passing the peace, no touch. And offering the way you give to the church will be different. And the ushers will not give you the printed bulletins. You will be asked to pick up your own, or you can find your bulletins on your seat. Things like that. But we'll get back to you with more detailed information. But please know, we will open on July 19th. So please pray for this, and please pray for those who prepared this process. And we also give you another announcement next Sunday, because we have this cleaning schedule and everything. And if you are healthy and if you want to volunteer for this process, please do so. But most of all, above all, everything, please pray for this. Lord, pour your grace and mercy on us, this new beginning. So we really need your prayer. Okay. So for all other detailed announcement, I want you to refer to our weekly email. But one thing, next Sunday, we have our online Holy Communion. I really don't know how was your first experience last month, but we will have our another online Holy Communion next Sunday. And please pray for those names you find in our weekly email, and please pray for them. All right, let us join our closing hymn.
I am on the battlefield for my Lord. I am on the battlefield for my Lord. And I promise him that I will serve him till I die. I am on the battlefield for my Lord. I'm on the battlefield for my Lord. I am on the battlefield for my Lord. And I promise him that I would serve him till I die. I am on the battlefield for my Lord. I was alone and idle, and I was a sinner too. I heard a voice from heaven said there is work to do. And I took my master's hand, and I joined the Christian band. I am on the battlefield for my Lord. I am on the battlefield for my Lord. I am on the battlefield for my Lord. And I promise him that I would serve him till I die. I am on the battlefield for my Lord. My Savior, I met him with a smile. He healed my wounded spirit and owned me as his child. Around the throne of grace, he appoints my soul a place, and I am on the battlefield for my Lord. I am on the battlefield for my Lord. I would serve him till I die. I am on the battlefield for my Lord. Now when I met my Savior, I met him with a smile. He healed my wounded spirit and owned me as his child. Around the throne of grace, he appoints my soul a place, and I am on the battlefield for my Lord. I am on
for my Lord. I am on the battlefield for my Lord. And I promise him that I will serve him till I die. And I am on the battlefield for my Lord.
Friends, thank you so much for worshiping with us today. A great cloud of witnesses surrounds us. May we follow in their footsteps of perseverance as we seek to move the mountains in our lives and in our world, always relying on God's grace. And now may the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you. Amen.
That saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I am found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. The Lord has promised good to His word, my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing God's praise than when